Hello, fourth graders. My name is Carly, and for those of you who don't know, I am Miss Combs's daughter, and currently I am an education student at Bryan College. So that means I'm studying to become a teacher. And so me and my mom had this good idea to read you guys a book called Shiloh. And so every day I'm going to record myself reading a chapter of this book, and I hope you guys can just listen and enjoy this while I know we're all, you know, can't go to school and kind of stuck in quarantine. We thought this would just be a good way to keep you guys encouraged to read and also just keep in touch. So if you have any questions for me or my mom or any predictions about this book or anything you'd like to say, just leave a comment underneath the video and we'll do our best to answer those questions. So, like I said, this book is called Shiloh, and it is by Phyllis Reynolds Naylor. And just to give you a little preview of the book, the back of the book says, Marty Preston is exploring the hills behind his family home when he chances upon a beagle, and that's when the trouble begins. The dog is thin and skittish, but comes right to Marty's whistle. He licks Marty's hand and follows him home, and just like that, Shiloh has squeezed himself into Marty's heart. But then, Marty begins to suspect that Shiloh is being mistreated by his owner, and Marty's dream to keep Shiloh becomes a mission. What is the right thing to do when a dog is being abused and belongs to someone else? What about when that someone else owns a gun? These are big questions that Marty finds himself facing, and he soon realizes he faces them alone. When he puts his courage to the test, he discovered that it is not always easy to separate right from wrong, and that sometimes all you can do is try to save the ones you love. So that just gives you a little preview. But today I'm going to read chapter 1. So I hope you guys just can listen and enjoy this with me. So, Chapter 1. The day Shiloh come, we're having us a big birthday dinner. Darylene's dipping bread in her glass of cold tea the way she likes, and Becky pushes her beans up over the edge of her plate in her rush to get them down. Ma gives us her scolding look. Just once in my life, she says, I'd like to see a bite of food go direct from the dish into somebody's mouth without a detour of any kind. She's looking at me when she says it, though. It isn't that I don't like fried rabbit. Like it fine. I just don't want to bite down on buckshot, is all, and I'm checking each piece. I looked that rabbit over good, Marty, and you won't find any buckshot in that thigh, Dad says, buttering his bread. I shot him in the neck. Somehow I wish he hadn't said that. I pushed the meat from one side of my plate to the other, threw the sweet potatoes and back again. Did it die right off, I asked, knowing I can't eat it at all unless it had. Soon enough. You shoot its head clean off, Darylene asks. She's like that. Dad chews real slow before he answers. Not quite, he says, and goes on eating, which is when I leave the table. The best thing about Sundays is we eat our big meal at noon. Once you get your belly full, you can walk all over West Virginia before you're hungry again. Any other day, you start out after dinner. You've got to come back when it's dark. I take the .22 rifle Daddy gave me in March on my 11th birthday and set it out up the road to see what I can shoot. Like to find me an apple hanging way out on a branch. See if I can bring it down. Line up a few cans on a rail fence and shoot them off. Never shooting anything moving, though. Never had the slightest wish. We live high up in the hills above Friendly, but hardly anybody knows where that is. Friendly's near Sisterville, which is halfway between Wheeling and Parkersburg. Used to be, my daddy told me, Sisterville was one of the best places you could live in the whole state. You ask me the best place to live, I'd say right where we are, a little four-room house with hills on three sides. Afternoon is my second best time to go up in the hills, though. Morning's the best, especially in summer. Early, early morning. On one morning, I saw three kinds of animals, not counting cats, dogs, frogs, cows, and horses, saw a groundhog, saw a doe with two fawns, and saw a gray fox with a reddish head. Betty's daddy was a gray fox and his ma was a red one. My favorite place to walk is just across this Radley Bridge where the road curves by the old Shiloh schoolhouse and follows the river. River to one side, trees the other, sometimes a house or two. In this particular afternoon, I'm about halfway up the road along the river when I see something out of the corner of my eye. Something moves. I look, and about 15 yards off, there's this short-haired dog, white with brown and black spots, not making any kind of noise, just slinking along with his head down, watching me, tail between his legs like he's hardly got the right to breathe. A beagle, maybe a year or two old. I stop, and the dog stops. Looks like he's been caught doing something awful, when I can tell all he really wants is to follow along beside me. Here, boy, I say, slapping my thigh. Dog goes down on his stomach, groveling above and about in the grass. I laugh and I start over toward him. He's got an old worn-out collar on, probably older than he is. Betty belonged to another dog before him. Come on, boy, I say, putting out my hand. The dog gets up and backs off. He don't even whimper, like he's lost his bark. Something really hurts inside when you see a dog cringe like that. You know somebody's been kicking at him, beating on him, maybe. It's okay, boy, I say, coming a little closer, but still he backs off. So I just take my gun and follow the river. Ever so often, I look over my shoulder, and there he is, the beagle. I stop, he stops. I can see his ribs. Not real bad, but he isn't plumped out or anything. There's a broken branch hanging from a limb out over the water, and I'm wondering if I can bring it down with one shot. I raise my gun and think, and then I think how the sound might scare the dog off. I decide I don't want to shoot my gun much that day. It's a slow river. You walk beside it, you figure it's not even moving. If you stop, though, you can see leaves and things going along. Now and then a fish jumps. Big fish. Bass, I think. Dog still trailing me, tail tucked in. Funny how he don't make a sound. Finally, I sit on a log, put my gun in my feet, and wait. Back down the road, the dog sits too. Sits right in the middle of it, head on his paws. Here, boy, I say again and pat my knee. He wiggles just a little, but he don't come. Maybe it's a she-dog. Here, girl, I say. Dog still don't come. I decide to wait the dog out, but after 3 or 4 minutes on the log, he gets born and I start off again. So does the beagle. Don't know where you'd end up if you followed the river all the way. Heard somebody say it curves about, comes back on itself. But if it didn't and I got home after dark, I'd get a good whooping. So I always go as far as the ford, where the river spills back across the path, and then I head back. When I turn around and the dog sees me coming, he goes off into the woods. I figure that's the last I'll see of the beagle, and I get halfway down the road again before I look back. There he is. I stop, he stops. I go, he goes. And then, hardly thinking on it, I whistle. It's like pressing a magic button. The beagle comes barreling toward me, legs going lickety-split, long ears flopping, tail sticking up like a flagpole. This time when I put out my hand, he licks all my fingers and jumps up against my leg, making little yelps in his throat. He can't get enough of me. Like I've been saying no all along, and now I'd said yes, he could come. It's a he-dog like I thought. Hey, boy, you're really something now, ain't you? I'm laughing as the beagle makes circles around me. I squat down and the dog licks my face, my neck. Where'd he learn to come if you whistled, to hang back if you didn't? I'm so busy watching the dog, I don't even notice it started to rain. Don't bother me. Don't bother the dog, neither. I'm looking for the place I first saw him. Does he live here, I wonder? Or the house on up the road? Each place we pass, I figure he'll stop. Somebody come out and whistle, maybe. But nobody comes out and the dog don't stop. Keeps coming even after we get to the old Shiloh schoolhouse. Even starts across the bridge, tail going like a propeller. He licks my hand ever so often to make sure I'm still there, mouth open like he's smiling. He is smiling. Once he follows me across the bridge, though, and on past the grist mill, I start to worry. Looks like he's fixing to follow me all the way to our house. I'm in trouble enough coming home with my clothes all wet. My ma's ma died of pneumonia, and we don't ever get the chance to forget it. And now I got a dog with me, and we were never allowed to have pets. If you can't afford to feed them and take them to the vet when they're sick, you've got no right taking them in, Ma says, which is true enough. I don't say a word to the beagle the rest of the way home, hoping he'll turn around at some point and go back. But the dog keeps coming. I get to the front stoop and say, "Go home, boy." And then I feel my heart squeeze up the way he stops smiling, sticks his tail between his legs again, and slinks off. He goes as far as a sycamore tree, lies down in the wet grass, head on his paws. "Whose dog is that?" Ma asks when I come in. I shrug. "Just follow me is all." "Where to pick up with you?" Dad asks. "Up in Shiloh across the bridge," I say. "On the road by the river? Bet that's Judd Traveler's beagle," says Dad. "He got himself another hunting dog a few weeks back." "Judd got a hunting dog? How come he don't treat him right?" I ask. How you know he don't?" "The way the dog acts. Scared to pee almost," I say. Ma gives me a look. "Don't seem to me he's got any marks on him," Dad says, studying from my window. "Don't have to mark a dog to hurt him," I'm thinking. "Just don't pay him any attention, he'll go away," Dad says. "And get out of those wet clothes," Ma tells me. "You want to follow your Grandma Slater to the grave?" I change clothes, then sit down and turn on the TV, which only has two channels. On Sunday afternoons, it's preaching and baseball. I watch baseball for an hour, then I get up and sneak to the window. Ma knows what I'm about. "That Shiloh dog still out there?" she asks. I nod. He's looking right at me. He sees me there at the window, and his tail starts to thump. I name him Shiloh. All right, so that's the end of chapter one. I hope you guys enjoyed it. So, like I said, leave some predictions of what you think is going to happen underneath, and let me know if you liked it or not. Thank you, and follow along tomorrow to read about chapter two. Bye, guys.